I'm Casey. I'm a professor, and I've been running PhD admissions for my department for a long time. This is yet another in my series of videos on applying for PhD programs. Last week I got on TikTok. This is funny in part because I think that it's like a particular stage of quarantine to get onto TikTok. And also, apparently, the older generation of TikTok are people who were born in the late 90s. So, you know, I'm like the crypt keeper. But the reason that I got on TikTok, actually, if you are watching this, I love you and appreciate you. And I really, really hope that I have been of great help in preparing your PhD applications. Statistically, according to YouTube analytics, you're also probably male, which is totally fine, but I was a little perplexed by this. And when I asked some people, hey, if I maybe wanted more women also to see my advice about applying to PhD programs, how would I reach them? And someone suggested TikTok. I was very skeptical, but I posted a couple of videos with advice for PhD applications set to trending TikTok music. What the TikTok algorithm is, but it got to the right people. So also this weekend, I posted on TikTok and offered to answer questions. And I got a lot more questions than I've gotten here, actually, at least in the comments. And so it actually gave me a really good sense of the kinds of basically frequently asked questions. Actually, the way that I framed it was, tell me your anxieties and I'll try to make you feel better.
Hello, 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 hello.
So another way to look at this is frequent anxieties about applying to grad school. Now, as always, my experience is much more with PhD programs than master's programs and more in STEM and other lab-based disciplines than humanities. However, some of this is broadly applicable, so I will let you take from it what is useful. A lot of the things I'm going to talk about here, I probably have also covered a little bit in other places, like in the PhD application tips video or the statement of purpose video. I'm going to try not to repeat things that I've talked about in detail in other places and cover some things that were a little bit more new. First, some form of how much does X matter? Where X was usually GRE scores, GPA, internships, etc. I will give you the general answer to this, which is that weaknesses in one area can always be made up for by strengths in another area. So for example, if your program requires test scores and your test scores are low, but you have really good research experience or really strong letters of recommendation, etc., it absolutely can make up for that. I'll be honest, my GRE scores were meh. I mean, they were fine, but they weren't stellar. And also on the topic of GRE, make sure that the programs you are applying to actually require it. I personally think that standardized tests are kind of garbage. For me personally, in reviewing PhD applications, I basically didn't look at them. I also helped convince our department to not require them anymore. though they are optional, such that if you think that they help you, you can submit them. I am seeing this increasingly commonly, but even if your program does require GRE scores, it's not the only thing that matters. Everything is considered ideally holistically, which means that, again, strengths can outweigh weaknesses. Emphasize your strengths. And if you're interested in how to do that in one particular context, my video about academic CVs talks about structuring your CV to emphasize your strengths. But let's talk specifically about grades. A lot of people are really, really worried about grades. I understand this. It's such a tangible number, kind of like test scores. And it really feels like if it doesn't meet some bar, that you're just totally out of luck. So another thing that I want to point out with grades specifically is that there are patterns in grades that an admissions committee might look for. One example is an upward trajectory. If you just totally blew your freshman year of college, but have gotten straight A's for the last 2 years, that says something. It matters. And of course, if you have very good grades through most of college and a single bad semester that pulls down your GPA, that's something that people notice too. Oh, like they were doing really good this whole time, and then what was happening this semester? Probably something, right? You don't have to disclose that. Sometimes it's just clear that something was going on with you and that your performance over one particular semester is not indicative of your general work ethic, ability, etc. Which brings me to another frequently asked question that honestly made me a little sad because I hadn't thought about how much this would be worrying people, which is my grades were really good and then there was a pandemic. A lot of people asked whether their recent performance in terms of grades or research productivity or whatever would kill their chances for getting into a grad program. My answer to this is, God, I hope not. I mean, I truly think that most people will understand or even expect that there's gonna be some negative glitches in someone's performance because of COVID. And honestly, if they don't have even that much compassion, then like, do you really wanna go to that program anyway? And finally, on grades in particular, you might consider if there really is something that is so significant that it requires some explanation, you can talk about something in your statement of purpose, personal statement, etc. But try to spin it as a positive. Even though, blah, 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 even though XYZ, I persevered and managed to do this, and I'm really excited to start my graduate training, etc. So that's some advice on that. And here is another frequently asked question. How do I ask faculty for letters of recommendation? This had some different variations. Some, the issue was, what if I've been out of school for a long time and they don't remember me? Or I don't think that I really got to know my professors that well. Or even, I'm nervous to ask them, I don't want to bother them, etc. I think my advice for all of these is, to be frank, faculty are sometimes easily flattered. Also, you need to jog their memory, potentially. I suggest reaching out for the first time with something that explains how your experience with this faculty member influenced your decision to want to go to graduate school. I really got so much out of your class. I learned about this. It made me want to explore this area more. I learned so much from our class discussions. The paper that I wrote for your class on XYZ made me realize that I can work in this space, whatever it is. It's gonna help them remember who you are. It's gonna help them remember the nice things they should say about you. And it's nice to say something nice. Another question I got was, some people also were anxious about the fact that faculty members hadn't submitted their letters yet. My response was usually, well, when is it due? Just as a general principle, professors often do things at the last minute. I would recommend, as a general timeline, though of course this may vary depending on your personal circumstances, ask them to do it at least a month in advance, if you can. If they haven't submitted it by then, remind them a week before the deadline, and that time ask for a response. Another question I saw a lot was about people switching areas. Like, I have a degree in X, but I want to go to graduate school for Y. Is that okay? Sure, especially if there's a connection between the two. My suggestion is in your statement of purpose to articulate very well what the connection between these two things are, how you made your way from A to B, and why you have a passion for B. And I also wouldn't be concerned, for example, about, oh, I've only done research in A. Like, honestly, for applying to graduate school, having any research experience at all is great. It doesn't have to be, like, in the exact same sub-area that you are going to graduate school in. Which brings me to another frequently asked question. I don't have any publications. Can I possibly get into a PhD program? And the answer is yes. I mean, I'm not going to try to tell you that it's not compelling when someone has publications. It is possible that someone's application will look stronger than yours because of that. But people who do not have publications already get into graduate school every day, even into PhD programs. I have admitted students to be my PhD advisees who do not have publications. In fact, probably most of them. I do not think that it should be some kind of prerequisite that somehow as an undergrad or even a master's student, you have first authored a paper in science or whatever. You are starting a PhD program, you are going to learn to write papers. The important thing, even if you don't have as much research experience as some other people, is to really articulate that passion and also research fit for that program. If you haven't seen it yet, definitely go look at my video about statements of purpose. And this issue of experience particularly brings me to another line of frequently asked questions. The first one being, do I have to have a master's degree to apply to a PhD program? The answer is no. I don't know where this is coming from, and maybe this is a disciplinary thing, but definitely a ton of people who think it is literally impossible to be accepted into a PhD program unless you already have a master's degree. Again, I don't know what it's like in other disciplines, but in computer science, information science, and related fields that I am familiar with, that's definitely not the case. Now, you might have a better chance because you have a master's degree, but not by virtue of having a master's degree. It's because if you've spent another 2 years doing stuff, it's more likely that you have more research experience, etc. But I don't care if a student has a master's degree or not. I care about all those other things that are on paper. And sometimes people coming straight out of undergrad have more research experience, for example, than someone with a master's degree. Right now, the students in the PhD program in our department, about 25% of them came straight out of undergrad. Which then brings me to the next question, which is, I've been out of school for a long time. Do I have a shot at getting into a PhD program? And my answer, also yes. Also, our PhD program has a significant number of students who started their PhD when they were over 30, some of which had been in the workforce for 10 years or more. And in that case, I think the really important thing is to articulate why you want to make this career shift. Why do you want to get a PhD? How is this going to help you meet your goals? Are you dedicated to becoming a researcher, et cetera, et cetera? But this question, am I too young to get a PhD or am I too old to get a PhD? The answer is no, you absolutely are not. All of these other things are what matters. I literally do not look at someone's age on their application. I do not care. But I really think that what I saw in these questions and anxieties was a lot of imposter syndrome. This isn't surprising, and unfortunately it's not gonna stop. You have imposter syndrome now because you think you can't get into graduate school. Once you're in graduate school, you will have imposter syndrome because you think you're an imposter and shouldn't be there. You're going to have it when you submit your first publication. You're going to have it when you're on the job market. You're going to have it when you are a faculty member, and you're going to have it after you have tenure. Even the academics that I know that I feel like are exceptionally confident still feel this sometimes. I have 4 degrees, a tenure track faculty job, a good number of publications and grants and all the stuff that matters. I have a marginally successful YouTube channel, and I still feel like I'm totally faking all of it. I don't mean to say this to be discouraging. I mean to say it as everyone feels this way. And so it's okay. You feel it, and then you push forward anyway. Don't listen to the little voice in your head. I believe in you. So did I miss any questions that you have? Feel free to leave them in the comments below. I mean, I answered probably 200 TikTokers, so like, I can answer you. And I know we're getting closer to application deadlines, which is why I'm trying to push out videos about this now. You get to hear about other stuff later. But I really hope that things are coming together for you. And I guess if you want my quicker hot takes on everything in between YouTube videos, you should go follow me on TikTok. So once again, and even if this is not the right year for you, for many reasons that might be outside of your control, make sure you check out the Reasons Applicants Are Rejected video, because this is really important. If this is what you really want, you want to be a researcher, you want to get a PhD, if you strike out this year, try again next year. And that's it for this edition of Casey Answers Questions from TikTok. Thanks for watching.
Girl, don't do it. It's not worth it. I'm not gonna do it, girl. I was just thinking about it. I'm not gonna do it. I did it.